Day after day, night after night, we have been thrilled and captivated by Budapest 2023. Jamaica securing 5 medals on day number 6, 2 gold, 2 bronze and 1 silver medal. The gold medals, Danielle Williams in the 100 hurdles and in the 400 meters, Antonia Watson, a silver medal in the long jump for Wayne Pinnock, a bronze medal in the long jump for Tajay Gale, and a bronze medal in the women's 400-meter hurdles for Rochelle Clayton. In our previous segment, we spoke about the women's 100-meter hurdles, and now we're going to be chatting, first of all, about the men's 400 meters. Lance Whitaker, Leighton Levy, and Danielle Dowie via Zoom, all with us as we recap day number 6 of the World Athletics Championships. Leighton Levy, I'll start this one with you. Antonia Watson, he started 2023 as a 46.17 man at 400 meters. I'll tell our viewers this, midway the season, I am not sure that his handlers knew which event he would run at the national championships and by extension the world championships, because they were still toying with the idea of him running the 200 meters. In many respects, I think he, even more than the handlers, was toying with the idea of running the 200 meters. But here he is, he's world 400 champion, Leighton Levy.
Absolutely. We saw him run a number of 200 at those meets, those all-common meets, and of course, what it may have been, though, was preparation for that speed for the 400. And eventually you saw those times begin to drop gradually during the course of the season, coming down to sub 45, 44, 54 in the national championships. And of course, in the first round, I mean, the semifinal round, 44-13. My only concern at the time, as I mentioned here, was whether or not he would be able to replicate that performance, because it does take a lot out of you when you're running all these PBs. It's like 3 PBs in a row almost. 44.7, 44.54, and then 44.13. It takes a lot out of you. And you saw that at the start of the race. He started out slowly, and he looked tired at 300. Actually, I thought he was dead at 300. And then I saw him do one of the basic things in track and field. You relax, and you drive. The harder you drive your arms, the better your legs move. And he stormed down the stretch, eased past the field. Another really great time, 44.22 for the gold medal.
Let me ask you, Leighton, before I bring Danielle Dowie in on this discussion, was it more a tactic on the part of Antonia Watson? Because today's run reminds me more of the old Antonia Watson, the one who would go out slowly and finish like a bullet. Remember, that's how he won his 2017 World Under 18 title, finishing like a bullet. And I just wonder if tactically he thought to himself, the men who go out hard might fade down the stretch and that will give me an opportunity.
It could have been, but I'm more inclined to believe that it was a fatigue factor where he was being cautious at the start of the race, hoping to have enough energy to come home.
Yeah.
I think when he realized where he was almost fifth as they came to the top of the stretch, he realized he probably had a little bit more energy than he believed that he would have had.
Yes.
And then just let it all out for the last 100 meters, and it worked. But I think if it was a strategy, it would have been a brilliant strategy if that was
the plan.
Yes. But the reality is, I think he was probably tired and was being cautious. We saw that in the national championships as well in the final, where he went out slowly but then finished strong and finished second behind Sean Bailey. So maybe it's a thing where he still doesn't trust his fitness levels at this level after having gone through two rounds of competition to be able to produce his best. But I think going forward, I believe that you'll see a different Antonia Watson in the first 200 meters. He'll be a lot faster, and I think he'll be more consistent in the 44 lows, because I think he proved it to himself today.
Yeah. Danielle Dowie, what does this victory mean for one, Antonia Watson, two, the Racers Track Club, the head coach of the Racers Track Club, Glenn Mills, his high school coach, Michelle Woolery, who is also still part of his coaching group at the Racers Track Club?
Well, first of all, big up Petersfield and Coach Woolery. You know, I think Antonio was so unaware of the history that he was creating. He was unconcerned, and I differ from Leighton in my analysis in that I think he ran with so much confidence and experience. I was really surprised at how maturely he executed his race. He saw everybody really gunning for it over the first 200, and he ran really measured and he didn't panic at all. At somewhere within at the 250 mark, he started to pick up the tempo. And those quite a few, about three athletes were ahead of him into the home straightaway. He relaxed into himself and trusted his speed, and he was very confident. So it was a very strong and a very experienced run for him, being 21 years old, and this is his first World Championship final. He ran like he's won this before. So I was really, really impressed with it. And in terms of racers, this is a big deal for them. His victory reminds me of the type of thing we see from Usain Bolt, something really confident. And so it's good to see racers, you know, get back into the limelight in terms of Zaniel Hughes and Oblique Seville. And now in the 400 meters, we normally mention racers in the shorter sprints. And now in the long sprint, the quarter mile event, they have a world champion, and that's good for them. So I'm really happy with his performance.
Just to add to Daniel's point, agreeing with her, mm-hmm. his composure in that last phase of the race was excellent.
Yes.
Because he could have easily have panicked and thrown it all away. But his composure, his self-belief, and of course, trusting himself, you know, brought it home.
In terms of the history that Danielle pointed to, the first world champion for Jamaica, 1983, Bert Cameron, came in the 400 meters. This is only the second time a Jamaican is winning the men's 400 meters at the World Championships. And the last time Jamaica got a medal in this event at the World Championships, 30 years ago, 2003, Michael Blackwood. And incidentally, that medal was an upgraded bronze medal because Michael Blackwood crossed the line fourth on the day. I'll never forget it when Marc Raquel of France leaned him out at the line. I almost cried on that day. No reason to cry today because it is a golden moment. We've discussed the women's 100 hurdles. We've also discussed the men's 400 meters. Let's now move to the men's long jump, where Jamaica secured two medals in this event for the first time in their history. Of course, James Beckford would have won two world championship silver medals. Tajay Gale won the 2019 title, and now silver for Wayne Pinnock, a world under 20 bronze medalist some years ago, upgrades that to a world championship silver medal, and Tajay Gale, the 2019 champion, securing bronze this time around, with Tentoglu, the Olympic champion from Greece, securing the victory. Before I go to anything else, ladies and gentlemen, I want to talk about the fact, and I hope on the part of the Jamaicans, that they lodged a protest and at least satisfied themselves that Tentoglu's final effort was indeed a foul. Because I note, Tentoglu thought it was a foul, it was ruled legal, but on the live feed, we never saw the foot placement, which is something you see almost after every jump, especially at this level. So that surprised me, Leighton, as I come to you first, and then you can give me your assessment of what was a thrilling event, regardless of that Tentoglu, I don't want to say controversy, but situation.
Yeah, I agree, because I actually had the same thought. I realized that it was very glaring that they didn't show you the footmark. They showed the footprints on everybody else. But then on the final jump, you heard the commentators say, was that legal?
Yes.
Then he jumped. Then you saw you didn't see anything about the foot placement. Then you saw the green flag come up to say the jump was legal. But you have to wonder why they didn't show that.
Yes.
But notwithstanding that, Tentoglu has a tendency, I remember I mentioned it here, he has a tendency to do this, where he waits until the last jump before he pulls off something spectacular. He's done it, he did it last year, he does it in the Diamond League a lot. So I was, you know, my wife was saying, and I was suggesting at the time that it looks like we're going to get the gold medal, and I said, wait until the last jump, because this guy has this tendency to do these things. And so said, so done.
Yeah, so this is it. He thinks it's a foul there. He shakes his head. He's saying no. And then the flag comes up green.
And he seemed surprised as well.
Yes. So and then we did not see.
Was that the jump? That was clean.
That wasn't the jump.
It may not have been the jump then, because that was clearly
That was his first jump. That's the jump that he jumped 8.50 on in the first jump.
Yeah, that looks like the 8.50 effort. Yeah. But still a fantastic event, and two medals for Jamaica.
Yeah, absolutely, and two medals, but two, three, and four.
Yes.
in the first time in history that Jamaica has ever had three people in the finals.
Livia, I want to ask you a question. And Lance Whitaker as well. This one for you. Do you remember, maybe about a month ago, when I said that within the next 3 years, in this cycle, that Jamaica's men will be 1, 2, and 3 in the long jump at a global championship?
Yeah, you did say that. Yeah.
I think you said so, yes, for real.
Well, it's not 1, 2, and 3, but it's pretty close.
Yeah, 2, 3, and 4. Yeah, but
your prediction time span hasn't elapsed yet.
No, not yet.
Yes. No.
But I thought Wayne Pinnock, in fact, all three of them were excellent. I thought Wayne Pinnock, you know, he rose to the occasion. 8 meters 50, then followed by 8 meters 40 to take the lead on the comeback. And he performed like somebody who's done this many, many times before. Yeah. Kerry McLeod had a misfortune of flying through the air like Superman and wanted to jump, so he slipped. And of course, Tajay Gale, the 2019 world champion, came through admitting afterwards that he re-injured his knee 2 weeks ago and still managed to come through for a bronze medal. You have to wonder just how much these guys are going to be able to accomplish, because they're all still very young.
Yes.
And then within the next 4 years, there's what? There's the Olympics next year, there's a World Championships in 2025,
yes,
and one in 2027. You have to wonder what they might be able to accomplish in that period, because the talent is clearly there to be built on.
Yeah. And can I tell you what is frightening about this event? That these men are not guaranteed to make the team next year.
No.
Because there are other quality jumpers
coming through
at the junior level who are already in the NCAA level. And so this is going to be one of the cracking events at the Olympic trials in Kingston next year. We're moving along. The women's 400 meter hurdles final, the final one of the day, Femke Bol of the Netherlands, remember, fell in the closing stages of the mixed relay. No falling today. She cleared all hurdles and she is world champion. But Rachel Clayton, a world championship bronze medalist in 2019, is a world championship bronze medalist again, and she does it in 52.81. I'll start with you, Daniel Dowie. You were competing then, Daniel, so I don't know if you remember the days when Rachel Clayton, and this is before 2019, she would turn up at the National Stadium to watch track meets with a broken leg, and she looked like an athlete who was not going to return, much less return to a level where she would win 2 world championship medals. I don't think people understand or even know the story of this woman, where she is coming from to get to this stage.
Well, Ricardo, I didn't get an opportunity to see her in that condition, but we were training partners my final year when I was training in competing in athletics, and she told me the stories of her days in the pool, what she had to do to recover from that fractured leg. And so to see her now repeat as a world champion, world championship bronze medalist, and doing it, you know, by descending into the level of greatness in the 400 meter hurdles, once you descend below the 53-second mark, you descend into the realm of greatness, Ricardo. She's a 52-second hurdler now, and I'm so happy for her. And she did it running blind. She was in lane 8. I would have hoped that she would have wanted to be somewhere nestled behind Femke Bol, the Dutch woman, so Femke could pull her into that faster time. But she was able to do it on her own, on the outside, feeling the pressure from the runners on the inner lanes. So it was a really good run for her. She's shown her class. She was very consistent coming into this championship and for the past couple of years. So it is a fitting reward for Rachel. And of course, we had the two other ladies, Genevieve and Anjanette, finishing 7th and 8th. Very good run. You know, they're still top 8 in the world. I'm sure there would be disappointment, because I said it was such a quality field that our medals could have come from any one of those ladies. But again, top 8, 3 women in the final. Jamaica created history again, just like in the men's long jump. So we have a lot to celebrate.
Yeah, a lot to celebrate indeed. And Leighton Levy, Daniel spoke about going sub 53. Only 2 Jamaican women have run faster than what Rachel Clayton produced. Malene Walker, 52.42, and Khalee Spencer, 52.79. Her 52.81 getting the better of Dion Hemmings-Makati, who ran 52.82. Remember, Dion Hemmings-Makati held the Olympic record from 1996 for a while. So it was a pretty special effort to win the bronze medal tonight.
Absolutely. And you saw that from the semifinals when she ran 53.3 and looked like she had a lot left in the tank after she came over the final hurdle. But one of the things, just to go back to the point about, you know, her injury issues, I remember after she got the bronze medal in 2019, I sat down for a radio interview with her, and we spoke at length about what her plans were for the following season, which was the Olympics for 2020. Of course, the pandemic then pushed it to 2021. But then, during that period, she also had injury issues that significantly impacted her preparation. So to see her now, 4 years later, come through and finally achieve her objective of running 52 is very, very heartwarming. And it just shows her resilience, because a lot of people would have probably given up given the challenges that she's had with injury and, you know, setbacks during the course of her career. For her to come back now and run 52.81, and she possibly could have gone faster had she had an inside lane, I agree with Daniel on that, is that she's now achieved her objective. So now she has to set new goals. And those new goals might be 52 low or 51 high, but she's actually now setting the trend for the upcoming 400-meter hurdles, because she's now clearly the leader in Jamaica.
Yeah, she is clearly the leader indeed. What a performance from Rochelle Clayton. What a performance from our Caribbean athletes on day number 6 in Budapest, Hungary. Thanks to Leighton Levy and Danielle Dowie, as the Jamaicans go to 8 medals. The English-speaking Caribbean moving to 10 medals overall after 6 days of the Budapest World Championships. Remember, you can catch it on the Sportsmax app in 15 territories across the region, and then you come to the Sportsmax Zone for the absolute best analysis there is on track and field in the world. We take a break. We'll be back with more on the Sportsmax Zone.